here this evening. Again, thank you, Sam, for making of our service today. We appreciate this morning. Pray for God's blessing on this evening as well. Notice sheet, you should have one. If you didn't have one this morning, it should be one stuck in your hymn book. If it's not, grab one from the back when you leave. There you go, there's lots of things on there. Lots of services on this week, and I'm sure some of us will forget something going on if you don't watch it. Bible study on Tuesday and Wednesday, coffee morning, Wednesday and Wednesday evening as normal. But also on Monday, starting this week, for the next 4 weeks, there's going to be a Christian discipleship course. And my dad's mum and I were joining the factory at the top there. On Monday evening at 7:30, if you're, most people are coming, already said they want to come, If anyone else is interested, please see over John or my dad afterwards. I'm sure that can be arranged. So that's tomorrow night at 7:30, if you're interested in learning a bit more about what it means to be a Christian. Also need for your prayers too, remember, not this week, but the following week, which is half term, because we've got a children's holiday club, the children's, please pray for those children. I'm very conscious and aware that I can't save anyone, and nor can any of us, can we? We have a great God, a faithful God that can do the impossible. So let's pray for his blessing on that opportunities for those children. Last year it'll be online. Thankfully this year it's back in the church. Unless something crazy happens in the next week. So let's pray for God's blessing upon that. Also, a little advance notice, the end of half-term week, on Saturday the 26th of February, we have got an anniversary service here because it's 10 years since we've been in this building. First moved in here. We had a holiday club here 10 years ago. That's the first time we used this building. So on the Saturday afternoon at 3 o'clock, Peter Atwell, we take a Thanksgiving service to God here. So we acknowledge and thank God for his faithfulness in the last 10 years. So I told you there's lots of notices to remember. It's packed, isn't it? And on the back, obviously, still there's many people within this fellowship who are associated with members of our families which are unwell. Our support, people need our prayers. Pray too for the online Bible study on Monday. Last week, no one turned up at all, so have nothing to talk to at all. So hopefully this week, just pray that people there soon, they'll be able to go back into prison again. Do the Bible studies like they used to in prison. And really, that's the notices. So Sam, thank you very much for yours.
Words from the prophet Isaiah. Behold, the Lord comes with might. His arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms, and he will carry them in his bosom and gently lead those that are with young. This is our God. And isn't it amazing that we get that contrast there just in those two verses, that here comes the Lord, he's coming to judge and his recompense is coming with him, but for his lambs, he gently picks them up, draws them into his bosom and carries them gently home. Well, I think it's right therefore that our first hymn is number 704. In your hymn books, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, poured incessantly from us. But God is so generous and so good to us that he never stops showing his gracious love to his sheep.
Streams of mercy.
are indeed the fount of every blessing. And Lord, from your hand come streams of mercy never ceasing. Lord, we thank you for this. And Lord, we thank you that there are people sat here this evening that can testify, that can speak and tell of your grace and your mercy throughout their lives. And Lord, even this week, even today, how you have shown your goodness over and over again. Lord, we thank you for that. And Lord, as we come, as your sheep to the shepherd, Lord, we come and we ask that you would feed us this evening. Lord, feed us from your word. Lord, we pray that you would lead us. Lead us as we seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, we pray, most of all, that you would show us Christ. Show us him in his beauty. Show us him in his glory. Lord, may our hearts be thrilled to see a clearer glimpse of him. Lord, capture our hearts and our minds. Lord, may we leave this place rejoicing in our hearts. All of the good things that you have done for us. Lord, may we more readily forsake our sins that so often we cling on to rigidly. Be seen for what they are, worthless, unable to satisfy. Lord, may it go further than that. We see them for the grotesqueness that they truly are. And Lord, how you see these things. And Lord, may that make us cherish and value Christ all the more. Father God, we echo those words that we sung as well, Lord. We are prone to wonder, and Lord, we feel it. Lord, we see, perhaps even this very day, that our hearts, our minds have wandered from you as they shouldn't have done. Lord, we pray that by your grace and by your Spirit, Lord, that you would join our hearts to you. Seal our hearts from heaven, we pray. Going to be the wisdom of God, the wisdom of God. And we're going to first read a chapter from Job 28. And this is a wonderful kind of poetic picture that we've got here of wisdom, like something precious that must be sought after, looked for, that we could seek under the earth and over the earth for. But where can we find it? So Job chapter 28, and we're going to read the whole chapter. So I think it's just a startlingly wonderful description of what wisdom is like. And then at the end, we find where wisdom is found. There is Job reasoning through these things. Surely there is a mine for silver, and a place for gold that they refine. Iron is taken out of the earth, and copper is smelted from the ore. Man puts an end to darkness and searches out the farthest limit. The ore in gloom and deep darkness, he opens shafts in a valley away from where anyone lives. They are forgotten by travellers and they hang in the air far away. From mankind, they swing to and fro. As for the earth, out of it comes bread, but underneath it is turned up as by fire. Its stones are the place of sapphires, and it has dust of gold. That path no bird of prey knows, and the falcon's eye has not seen it. The proud beasts have not trodden it. The lion has not passed over it. Man puts his hand to the flinty rock, and overturns mountains by the roots. He cuts out channels in the rocks, and his eye sees every precious thing. He dams up the streams so they do not trickle, and the thing that is hidden he brings out to light. But where shall wisdom be found? And where is the resting place of understanding? Man does not know its worth, and it is not found in the says, it's not in me, and the sea says, it is not with me. It cannot be bought for gold, and silver cannot be weighed as its price. It cannot be valued in the gold of Ophir, in precious onyx or sapphire. Gold and glass cannot equal it, nor can it be exchanged for jewels of fine gold. No mention shall be made of coral or of crystal. The price of wisdom is beyond pearls. The topaz of Ethiopia cannot equal it, nor can it be valued in pure gold. Where then does wisdom come? Where is the place of understanding? It is hidden from the eyes of all living and concealed from the birds of the air. Abaddon and Death say, we have heard rumour of it within our ears. God understands the way to it. He knows its place. For he looks to the ends of the earth and sees everything under the heavens. When he gave to the wind its weight and apportioned the waters by measure, when he made a decree for the rain and a wave for the lightning of the thunder, when he saw it and declared it and established it and searched it out, and he said to man, behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom, and to turn away from evil is understanding. What wonderful poetic words we have there, don't we? It doesn't matter where we search the depths of the earth and the deepest minds in the most far-flung marketplaces around our world, where can we find wisdom? But it is found with God, and the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom. Well, number 638 in our hymn books is asking the Lord to be our vision. That is, be thou my vision.
My heart.
God's word again, shall we? So if you'd like to open up your Bibles again, but this time at Proverbs. The book of Proverbs, it's just after the book of Psalms, about halfway through, you get to Proverbs. We're going to open up with Proverbs chapter 1. We're just going to look at the first 7 verses as our verses to consider this evening. And Proverbs really is a book of heavenly wisdom. And so the theme that we were thinking just from Job 28 very much is picked up here as well in Proverbs. So Proverbs chapter 1, starting at verse 1. The Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel. To know wisdom and instruction, to understand words of insight, to receive instruction in wise dealing, in righteousness, justice, and equity, to give prudence to the simple, knowledge and discretion to the youth. Let the wise hear and increase in learning, and the one who understands obtain guidance. To understand a proverb and a saying, the words of the wise and their riddles. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. That there are young people here in the church, and it's great to be able to see some of them and speak to some of them this morning. But it's a privilege, isn't it, to be able to minister as a church or as individuals in the lives of young people. So we're going to pray for the young people of this church and other churches that they would know the wisdom of God that we find in Christ Jesus. They have received that indescribably precious gift in their lives. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you that indeed wisdom is more valuable than gold, more valuable than precious rubies and sapphires. Lord, we thank you that nothing can be compared to it, because it is, Lord, it is in true wisdom that we see Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray therefore for the young people of this church. Lord, we pray for the children of this church. Lord, what a wonderful privilege you have given to the folk here, that there are our children among their number. Lord, we pray that this would be seen as an awesome responsibility for those that serve and minister to these children. Lord, we pray that you would be with those who teach children at holiday clubs and Bible clubs and in children's sessions. Lord, we pray that you would give them words to speak. Lord, we pray that you would cause them to picture Jesus Christ in the way that they proclaim Jesus with their words, but also in the way that they work together as a team. And Lord, as the adults of this church work together in the ministry of the gospel of Jesus Christ, Lord, we pray that there would be a love and a unity on the folk of this church. Lord, we pray there would be a deep family atmosphere that would speak of the bond of brotherhood and friendship that is in the family of Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray for every single one of these children, Lord, because we know that apart from you there is no hope for them. Lord, we know apart from you they face a hostile and turbulent world, a world that can give them no answers to the problems of difficulty and suffering, can give them no meaning to the hardships that they may face in their lives. Lord, can give them no hope for the future. But Lord, with Jesus Christ. Lord, with Jesus Christ, there is a hope for the future. Lord, there is forgiveness of sins. Lord, there is comfort to those who find themselves beaten hard by the world. Lord, there is peace for those who find themselves in the trials and storms of life. Lord, there is eternal comfort and joy in Christ Jesus. Lord, there is a heavenly resting place. But Lord, we thank you that as well as the death. Lord, as we struggle onwards towards our eternal glory, Lord, we can know that you are with us and you never leave us and you will never forsake us. Lord, we pray that the children of this church would know that. Lord, that they would know the all-surpassing worth of having Christ as their good shepherd. That they would hear his voice and recognize his voice on the lips and the words of those that minister here, on the lips and the words of their parents. Lord, we pray that they would come to follow and love Jesus Christ above all, that they would cherish him and hold fast to him as he holds fast to them. Lord, we pray that as a church, this would be a church that values and protects the young people here. We pray this in Jesus' name. access to information is more plenteous than it has perhaps ever been before. 24/7 at our fingertips, we can have access to all sorts of facts and figures. We can have access to all sorts of articles and interesting things. Every day, this is one statistic I found, every day 500 million tweets are posted on Twitter. That's the equivalent to a 25 million page book every single day. And that will happen tomorrow and the day after. And that's just one social network. 2.2 million books are published every year. That's a colossal amount of information, isn't it? And that's before we think about all of those pictures that are posted up online. All of the videos and instructional videos that are posted online, you can learn how to do all sorts of things, from knitting and sewing online. You can learn woodwork online. You can learn all of these amazing things. There's such a vast array of information in our world. We're utterly awash with information. But we're a world dying of thirst for true wisdom. And so, amongst all of this information overload, but this drought of wisdom, we ask ourselves, well, how can I be truly wise? How can I live wisely? And what we find from this passage is that the thing that we cannot go without, the very starting point of all of this, is a right fear of God. And we're going to come on to exactly what that means in a moment. But first of all, I just want to outline five purposes of gaining true wisdom. And we get this just in these first opening verses of this passage. So first of all, in verse 2, to know wisdom and instruction, and to understand words of insight. Verse 2. So the purpose of these proverbs is to give wisdom. And our first reading from Job 28 showed us that wisdom is like this rare resource, like gold or jewels or diamonds or pearls that you would find. They're hard won. They're rare. They're valuable. And in the same way, we're supposed to learn from this that wisdom, true heavenly wisdom, is hard won. It's valuable. It's precious. The word instruction that we have here, I don't know which translation you might have in front of you, but it can also mean correction or discipline in some translations. And this kind of helps us gain in our mind what's being talked about here as well, that wisdom needs to be sought after. It doesn't land in our laps. We need to be disciplined when we seek out for it. It needs to be honed, like a sportsman. A sportsman needs a lot of discipline and training. They need to get up early. They need to train. They need to focus and study those who have fantastic technique. And then try and imitate those things themselves. A very serious sportsman, they dedicate their lives to this thing. It's what they think about. It's what they consider. It's what they dream about day after day. And so the same is wisdom. There are no shortcuts to heavenly wisdom. There is no, in our instant world, we like everything to come really quick, don't we? You know, we love things like microwave meals that come quickly to us. We can get food quickly and on the go. We like things, especially when it comes to reading books and things, when you can get a summary, you know, a really short book to give you a lot of information. We like it when things are kind of boiled down and condensed in an easy way, and even easier than a book. 20-minute video on YouTube or something like that, just to make it quick. But there is no get wise quick technique. There is none of that. We're supposed to understand that if we're going to cultivate wisdom in our lives, it'll be like cultivating plants. It's going to take patience. It's going to take real patience. And actually, our desire to cut corners will probably cause us more trouble than it's worth. Need to be able to take time to mull over the teachings of God, to ponder them, to really immerse our minds in them, to go about a day or a week, to sit down and just think about things for some time. That is one of the purposes of Proverbs. But the other purpose of Proverbs are to understand words of insight as well at the end of verse 2. That is a kind of strange paradox here. You learn wisdom to recognize wisdom. So you learn good wisdom so that when we go out in the world and we see various suggestions that are put to us, or when people say, this is the way that you should live, you'll recognize it. The idea is that we kind of get a sense for it. That when things that are unwise are presented to us, you know, maybe our kind of spiritual alarm bells are starting to ring in our heads. When someone brings false teaching, we can almost smell it. And we know that something's not quite right here. We might not be able to put our finger on it straight away. It might take us a little bit longer to really figure these things out. But actually, we get a kind of sense in our bones of what real wisdom is. An illustration that was used in one of the books I was reading to prepare this was a person who is used to identifying fraudulent banknotes. And their job is to become so familiar with a genuine banknote, they kind of know the smell and the feel, the texture of a real banknote, that when a fake one is put in their hands, they can tell it almost instantly. And it might take them a couple of minutes to point out to you what those things are. But almost by instinct, they know these things. Or they say that a great chess player, they kind of have an instinct about what their a good move will be. And they'll think through afterwards. But often they say that the great chess players, their first instinct will often lead them to the best move. And after they've thought about it and thought of all the possibilities, it often comes out that actually their instincts were right. And that's what wisdom is trying to hone in God's people. And one of the great things about the book of Proverbs is, so often in our lives, we often say, well, can't the Bible just tell me everything I'm supposed to do? Have you ever had that? You know, can't the Bible just tell me who it is I'm supposed to marry? Or can't the Bible just tell me what sort of job I should get? But actually, what God wants us to do is he wants us to learn to think like him. He wants us to learn to have the same values as him. So that when different things come along our paths, different things which can't be outlined in a book of just a few thousand pages that we have in the Bible, that actually we think like God when we start to solve these problems and come to solutions. There are laws in God's word. They are there to direct us. You know, the person that you marry should be a godly believer like you are. And things like this. But also there's a lot of wisdom in God's word that teaches us to have a sense of what the right things are to do, which God's laws don't always address directly. So, the third purpose of Proverbs that we find in the Bible is that so we can learn to live wisely, and we see this in verse 3, to receive instruction in wise dealing. Righteousness, justice, and equity. And what's interesting about this is that it teaches us that living wisely is practical. It's not just up here. It's not just something that we kind of collect and hoard all this information and wisdom, like some sort of dragon which hoards jewels and gold in its lair. No, it is something that is of practical use to us every single day. That as you get up tomorrow morning and you go about your life, God's heavenly wisdom will be of use to you as well. It's not cleverness or intelligence. That contrasts with often what the world often will think about wisdom. The world often sees that every problem in our society, every problem in our lives, can have a technical solution to it. This is why the government are always looking at passing new laws. That if they just get the law right, then they'll be able to solve society's problems. If they just get the right social program, they'll be able to solve society's problem. Well, sometimes we can have similar kind of thought. If we have a problem with anger in our lives, we might go, well, can I go to the GP and see if he can prescribe me something for my anger? Or we have problems with teenage pregnancy, and we say, well, maybe we can solve this through simply more contraception or technical solutions. There's something about our world that is, that their understanding of wisdom means that they're always looking for a technical solution to problems that are often located in the heart. But wisdom has a clear moral dimension to it. Notice this in verse 3. In wise dealing, in righteousness, justice, and equity. Biblical wisdom has a moral dimension to it. We see that as well at the end of that passage in Job. To hate evil, to reject evil, is to have true knowledge. And so this is what we're supposed to understand, that there's a strong moral dimension, as far as the Bible is concerned, to true wisdom. That's very, very different to the way that our world views wisdom. Our world will often view wisdom in a kind of neutral form. But wisdom in the Bible always has a strong moral dimension as well. To love what is good, to humble ourselves before God, is good. To be arrogant and to love evil is foolishness, as far as the scriptures are concerned. But also notice verse 4, to give prudence to the simple. To give prudence to the simple. And this is helpful, actually, isn't it? That wisdom starts and it can meet us wherever we are. We can be simple, but if we come humbly, empty-handed, to God's fountain of wisdom, then he will graciously grant it to us. And in fact, there's a kind of paradox here. It is when we recognize that we are simple, when we recognize just how little wisdom that we have, that we find ourselves actually coming to God, that we find ourselves actually walking in the way of wisdom. And the other paradox is it's those who are wise that realize their need of wisdom. Those who are foolish that think they are wise and in arrogance. But notice also, to give prudence to the simple, knowledge and discretion to the youth. Now the NIV has a footnote here, and I think it's a helpful footnote. To give prudence to the simple, the Hebrew word here for simple means gullible, without moral direction, and inclined to evil. Gullible, without moral direction and inclined to evil. And this actually, I think, just gives a little window, and it's a little snapshot of the Bible's kind of understanding, of the scriptures' understanding, of youth and childhood as well. Because in our world, there's a stark contrast between what people out there in our society believe about youth and childhood and the nature of children and what the Bible teaches. And these are in direct contradiction to one another. So, for example, the Bible will teach that we are born sinful, fallen human beings. We're born of Adam's line, and by nature we desire to do things that are sinful. From the very womb we come sinful. And Jesus then later on goes on to say that it's not from outside that defilement comes, it comes from inside. Have evil desires in our hearts that come wickedness and envy and malice and strife. And so what are we going to think about when it comes to how we raise children in that case, if that's what we believe? Well, how is a church going to seek to lead children in that case? Well, they're going to see that these children need teaching, that they need the Word of God, that they need their characters shape, they need correction, that they need to be shown what it is to live a just and righteous life, a life of righteousness, justice and equity and fairness. That children will do things that are wrong. That they need to be shown grace and they need to be shown the way of Jesus Christ to become a functioning member of society. Now the way the world views things is very, very differently. You see, the world believes that children are born they're born innocent, and that then corruption comes from society later on at another point. And so the role therefore of teaching, as far as the world is concerned, and and it's increasingly going further this way, is it's not so much to instruct children and to correct children, but to kind of unleash children, to facilitate self-expression and let them tell you who they are. And in that sense, it's no surprise now that we've got the confusion of little boys thinking that they're little girls and little girls thinking that they're little boys. And all these things that now have really confused children. It's not surprise that the world for the last 10 years or so has been looking to a young teenage girl, Greta Thunberg, to teach them how to respond to the climate crisis, who has no understanding of science and things like that. And yet, why do they turn to her? Because they believe there's a sense in our society that she is pure, that she can speak to these corrupted adults and help them. There's a stark contrast to what the scriptures would say, to what our society now holds on to. We've got to understand that. Number five, another reason that we have Proverbs in the Bible, to get us thinking, to get us thinking, to, as it, in verse 6, to understand a proverb and a saying, the words of the wise and their riddles, that we would start to think kind of in time with God, that we'd really mull these things over, chew them over, these proverbs and saying, to cultivate a desire within us to think more deeply about life, to think more deeply about ourselves and others around us, to think more deeply about who God is and the nature of God. To always have a desire to get to the heart of the matter, not to think superficially like our world thinks. To have a desire not to just cover things quickly, but to maybe cover things at length as well. To understand a proverb by saying the words of the wise and their riddles. But that is really just the preamble to bring us to the main point in verse 7. This is our second point. Our second point is the heart and foundation of all wisdom, the fear of God. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom, the beginning of knowledge. But it's not like the beginning of knowledge, as in you learn this and then you move on to something else later on. You leave that behind and move on. But it's more like the foundation. You can't kind of say, well, I'm going to start my house with a foundation and then move on and build the rest of the house somewhere else, not on that foundation. You're going to have trouble, aren't you? Foundation then has to stay when you do everything else. And so the fear of God is the foundation of everything that a person can truly understand about the world and wisdom. Everything else must be built on this. And so this is absolutely critical in the Christian life. If we're going to live a wise life, this is absolutely critical that we grasp this and take this to heart. Now, the word fear there may cause some of you to recoil, because there's something about us that goes, well, why are we supposed to fear God? Doesn't it say later on that perfect love casts out fear? That's not a good thing, is it? Is the Bible contradicting itself in various places? Well, it might be that you're kind of getting fear of God that's spoken about here just a little bit wrong. And for a couple of examples, I just want to take you to Jeremiah 32, verse 38. And this is some of the wonderful promises that God gives, that he will create a new covenant with his people. And so here we have in Jeremiah 32, verse 38. And they shall be my people, and I will be their God. And I will give them one heart and one way, that they may fear me forever, for their own good and for the good of their children after them. I will make with them an everlasting covenant. I will not turn away from doing good to them, and I will put the fear of me in their hearts, that they may not turn from me. I will rejoice in doing them good. Now, listen to this, that God is going to do good to the people by putting his fear. heart. So whatever this fear is, it's good for the people. It is wholesome for the people. Whatever this fear that's being talked about here, and this is the promise of the new covenant, so it's not just Old Testament time, because sometimes we might say, well, fear of God is what they did in the Old Testament, when Moses was up Mount Sinai and that the mountain burnt and the people trembled. But also notice in Isaiah chapter 11, these are some verses very similar to what we were considering this morning with this stump and the root of Jesse. So in Isaiah chapter 11 and verse 1, we have, "There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse," talking about the Lord Jesus Christ here, "and a branch from his root shall bear fruit. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him," that's Jesus, "the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of the knowledge and the fear of the Lord." Now notice verse 3 particularly, "And his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord." And he's delighting in the fear of God here. Now how does someone delight in the fear of God? Unless there's something more that we're to understand about what it means to fear God. How is that compatible with a perfect Messiah that has a perfect relationship with his Father, that he is delighting in the fear of God? Now, John Bunyan is very helpful. I got this from a book by a man called Mike Reeves, Rejoice and Tremble. But he quotes John Bunyan. As he says, there's two understandings of fear that we can have, that we find in the scriptures. One is a slavish kind of fear, the kind of fear that drives us away from God, that says, God is holy, and I am sinful, and I can't be near God. I must flee from his presence. And then there's another type of fear. It's called filial fear, or kind of family fear. And it's a fear formed in love that draws us closer to God. So one drives us away, and one draws us closer into God, a right fear. Now the origins of this first fear, this slavish fear, where do we find that? Well, the first time we see it is in the Bible. It is in the Bible, but it's in Genesis. It's in Genesis chapter 3, in the garden. And this is where we see it. It was Adam and Eve, they've eaten from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. They used to have perfect fellowship with God, but when they eat of it, they notice that they're naked, and shame comes upon them. And then in verse 8, "And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man and said to him, 'Where are you?' And he said, 'I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid.'" And that is this fear that hides Adam from God. He can no longer be in God's presence. He's driven from the presence of God by this sense of shame and an uncleanness, which is true. It is a fear which drives us from God, separates us and hides us from God. But what we need to understand is, and what Bunyan then points out, is he points out that this, in a sense, is exactly what Satan wants to happen. And so when you look at the sin in your life and you say, well, I can't come to God. I can't pray today because I've sinned before God. I can't do my devotions today because I'm aware of this sin that I've done today in my life. And my conscience is reminding me. He says, well, can't you notice the very poor of the devil in those words in your mind? How can I come to God like this? This is an echo of Satan's lie. Now, Satan has basically two essential lies that he loves to tell believers. One is that sin is not serious. Don't worry about your sin. It's only a small thing to sin. And he draws us in. And he convinces us that this sin won't be too much of a problem in our lives. But then the second thing that he then tells us is that sin is so serious that God cannot receive us. Now notice the contradiction between those two. But that's no problem for him, because so often we buy that lie and we swallow that lie whole, don't we? It's why actually, man loves idols because idols are silent and mute and still. They're less terrifying than the judge of heaven and earth. Notice also that this even finds its way echoed in the very parables of Jesus. We see this in Matthew chapter 25, and that the parable of the talents, you remember that parable where the ruler's servants are given various amounts of money to go and invest it, and when he comes back, he asks them what they've done, and then one of them has had kind of 10 talents, and one of them's had 5 or 2 talents, depending on which version of the parable you've got, and he said, well done, you've invested it, you've made 10 more, you've made 5 more. And then he comes to the one who was given 1 talent in verse 24. He also, who had received 1 talent, came forward, saying, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. You see this fear? He's fearful of the master. It drives him away from service of his master. Now, don't you see your own heart in this? Do you see your own life in this? And maybe you're not a believer and you've never come to follow Jesus Christ. Perhaps you've always stayed at arm's length to the words that are spoken in this church. But you said, I can't come to God like this. Well, this is the very thing that will keep you away from God. This is the very thing that will keep you far from God. But I want to present to you something better. If you're a Christian and you find this tendency in your heart as well when you sin, and you find it takes you an awful long time to come around to these things, may I present to you something better. And that is a wholesome fear of God, this second filial fear of God that we can have. What is a wholesome fear of God? Well, it's a fear that drives us back to God, not away from God. It's in a sense, we could say this fear of God is a full and right relationship with God. It finds its basis in what he has done for us in Jesus Christ. He has redeemed us. He has ransomed us. He has washed us. He has forgiven us. He has clothed us in Christ's righteousness. He has called us his children, his beloved, his precious. We are his. This type of fear is a correct response to how God reveals himself to be. It's a correct response to our knowing that God is a God full of justice but also mercy. It's a correct response to our knowing that God is a God abundant in his mercy and his grace towards those who are sinners. It's tragic, actually. I think of so many people, either my own age or young people that I've worked with as a youth worker, and I realise that so many have walked away from Christ, and that they've done something in their lives, and there's a sense that they can never go back. Perhaps they've had a relationship with someone they shouldn't have had a relationship with, and the relationship has become physical, and everyone knows that because they're living together. And they know, I can't go back now. I can't walk back into church after this relationship has fallen apart. But the truth is, there is one place in all the world where grace can be found. There is one place where forgiveness can truly be found. It is in the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is in the blood of God himself shed on the cross. The blood of God's Son shed the highest price ever paid for forgiveness, that true forgiveness can be found. Remember this. Remember this if you find yourself in the depths of shame and guilt, that there is forgiveness at the cross of Jesus Christ. Yes, he is a holy judge, righteous and pure, but he is also a saviour, a redeemer. God is mighty and terrifying, yet in Christ, his might is for us and not against us. chosen, the offspring of Abraham, my friend, you whom I took from the ends of the earth and called from his father's quarters, saying, you are my servant. I have chosen you and not cast you off. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Behold, all who are incensed against you shall be put to shame and confounded. Those who strive against you shall be as nothing and shall perish. Those who contend with you, you shall seek those who contend with you, but you shall not find them. Those who war against you shall be as nothing at all. For I, the Lord your God, hold your right hand. It is I who say to you, fear not, for I am the one who helps you. Fear not, you worm Jacob, you men of Israel. I am the one who helps you, declares the Lord. Your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. Reminds me of those words in Romans. If God is the one who justifies, if God is the one who is the standard of righteousness and justice and purity and equity, if he is the one who justifies and declares not guilty, what voice in all heaven and earth can say otherwise? If the voice who spoke the heavens into being, who spoke the stars into existence and the earth into existence and all life into existence at the power of his word, if he says, this one is mine and is washed and forgiven and not guilty, who in all the earth can say guilty when God has declared it otherwise? C.H. Spurgeon, he said these words, I love to hear the lightnings. God's thunder is my delight. It is my voice that I hear. But in some ways, thunder and lightning can be terrifying. And yet, knowing it's your Father's voice can change it completely. And you might ask, well, how do I come to God when I'm feeling like this? Well, know this, that God has come to us. We're thinking about the wisdom of God. And God has revealed his wisdom to us. In John chapter 1 and verse 1, we hear this echo of the Genesis account of creation. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. And this is Jesus Christ that's being talked about here as the very Word and truth of God, the very wisdom of God. This word here is logos, and it's what the Greeks understood is the founding wisdom of the universe. This very wisdom of God came to us, we read later on in John chapter 1. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And to all those who did receive him, it also says in John chapter 1, who received Jesus Christ, he gave the right to become children. And so here's the thing. If you receive Jesus Christ, you receive the forgiveness of God. You're receiving the very wisdom of God himself. The fullness of the revelation of God's wisdom is to receive Jesus Christ. The wisest thing any person can ever do in all their life is to receive Jesus Christ and to follow him. The most foolish thing a person can ever do is when God has decisively revealed his wisdom to all mankind. When God has come and walked on the earth in the flesh. When God has displayed his glory to mankind in a person that has made more impact on our world than anyone else who has ever lived, breathed, and walked on this planet, is to then reject that Jesus Christ. That is the most foolish thing a person can do. Died to make a way back to him. We read in another kind of, as it were, gloriously stupendous passage in Colossians chapter 1. We have these words, that he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for by him all things were 19, for in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. And you might think that that is the absolute pinnacle of what he could say about Jesus Christ, but here's something special for us. And through him, to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. It's what you do with Jesus Christ that defines everything. It's what you do with this Jesus Christ, the revelation of the wisdom of God, that will define whether you are on the path of foolishness and destruction or the path of wisdom. So this is why it's the first lesson. This is why it is the foundation. Because if God is the fountain of wisdom, we must be in communion with God to receive his wisdom. Later on in James's epistle, it says, if anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask God. If you're in communion with the very source of all wisdom, then you will grow, brothers and sisters. That is where you will go, to the very fount of wisdom, to God himself. Father God, we pray, Lord, we pray that we would have Jesus Christ as the foundation of our lives, the foundation of our wisdom, Lord, that having him sat upon the throne of our hearts would be the way that we are led by a shepherd in the paths of righteousness and goodness. That we are led on your paths and taught from your hand and by your voice. Lord, we pray that as your people we would hear your voice and follow you. But Lord, we pray that anyone here this evening that has not received and heard that call, Lord, that tonight would be the night that they do so. Lord, that tonight would be the night that they hear through the preached word, through the reading of your word, the voice of their Creator. Lord, the voice of shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace.